why you should put solar panels on your roof before you retire. Now, this might seem interesting for those of you who follow the channel and know my my take on solar, on wind, on climate change, heaven forbid, global warming. However, the one thing that I do know for a fact is what the most important thing when it comes to your retirement is actually your consumption, your expenditures. And what's the number one part of your expenditures, we know, is housing. And what's a big portion of the housing cost, well, is going to be your utility bill, in this case, your electric bill. So, when is it more likely that you'll have the resources and actually the desire to make any kind of significant investment into your home, either putting a second bath on your home or doing any kind of engagement to upgrading your home? Well, it's why you're working, why you got cash flow coming in, because no one likes to take money out of their IRA retirement accounts in order to finance things. No one likes to do that because it makes them scared, but they don't mind doing it from cash flow. I mean, people, Richard Thaler, Dan Kahneman, they've won Nobel Prizes on this very premise. It makes people nervous to draw down assets, capital assets. They'd much rather spend their income. So while you're working and you have income coming in, it's a good time to actually invest in upgrades because, more, A, you're likely to do it, B, you're not likely to freak out about doing it as well. All right, and on top of that, if it turns out that you didn't quite have what you needed, what you thought you needed to retire at the time you want to pull the plug, you can hang in there for an extra year or two to make good on where you think you need to be. All right, so let's go back to utility electricity consumption, why solar is the way to go. How is your utilities charged? Well, they charge by kilowatt hour. And again, I'm using utility and electricity kind of synonymously here. It's kilowatt hour. So they charge you a certain amount per kilowatt hour. What is one of the basis that your utility company structures their cost per kilowatt hour? Well, it's a cost for them to provide you the electricity to begin with, to create it, to produce it, to transmit it, and to deliver it to your home. Now, what we have here is in Atlanta, it's about 8 cents a kilowatt hour right now for a typical. I have Sony Electrical, I can't remember his name, Sony EMC, I forgot what the MC stands for. So anyway, either way. So I'm paying about 8 cents a kilowatt hour here in Atlanta. Some places it's 14 cents a kilowatt hour. I think in Texas, like 7 cents. But electricity and energy is a huge political football, huge. Is a certain group of people get more elected, that political football is going to turn against you in terms of the cost for your electricity. The kilowatt hour is going to rise substantially. The reason for that is because they're going to put more and more regulations on the utilities to provide more of their electricity from green sources, i.e. solar and wind. It's never nuclear, which is odd, actually, because nuclear is a wonderful anti-greenhouse gas, and there's no emissions from nuclear, and it's wonderful, but they never do that. It's always solar and wind, and maybe hydro, but we can't get hydro here in Atlanta. And so for most of the United States, it's going to be solar and wind. All right, so the more regulations they put on these utilities to provide their customers with electricity via renewables, the more expensive it's going to be because the utility is just going to pass that expense on to the end user, which is the consumer. Well, I mean, this really is not really debatable, frankly. Now, you might say that's good or bad. I frankly disagree, but you could say that, and that's fine. But either way, the consumer will end up paying more. What's one way that a consumer can maybe work around that? Well, it's by installing the photovoltaic panels now so they can have a fixed cost of their what they're putting on there today in order to generate a certain amount of kilowatt hours that they know for a fact will be used, you know, ideally, that won't cost them anything. And either they can sell it back to the grid or they don't have to buy it from the grid. Either way, they know they are locking in a fixed cost today with their solar panels to generate electricity that they can use that in the future will not have inflation costs, won't have regulatory costs. Nothing like that. So let's just say it costs you $30,000 to put, you have a south-facing home, you're gonna put some photovoltaic panels on your rooftop, it costs you $30,000. All right, and I don't know what the amortization is. Say it's 4.9%, I'm driving, so I don't know what the amortization is. But if you take your $30,000 over 60 months, you're gonna pay it back in 60 months, literally just say it's $500 a month. Probably a little bit more. We'll say $600 a month. So you know it's going to be $600 a month between now and it'll be paid off. All right. So by then, your solar, your electricity generation, maybe not 100%, but a significant amount of that will be locked down. You'll never have another cost for that ever. Obviously, you might have to get change out your solar panels. You might have to get it cleaned. You might have to get it renewed. I mean, all the lines, all that stuff. But in terms of just basic maintenance, there's always going to be a cost for maintenance. But in terms of the cost of kilowatt hour to turn your TV on to run your fridge and all that, those days are gone. Because either A, you're consuming it, or you're selling it back to the grid. One of those two things. I mean, it's wonderful. But it does cost you something up front. That's something up front that you're doing today, though, is less of a burden to you because you have your labor income that you're using in which to pay for that. And so essentially saying, look, I need to use my labor income today in order to lock down my electricity bill in the future. That way, if AOC or the Green New Deal passes and we go hugely away from fossil fuels, heaven forbid, but you know, you never know, and I need to get electricity, I won't have to be the guinea pig for my utility, which is going to pass that cost on to me. Because when we talk about the Green New Deal, we're never talking about nuclear. We're always just talking about solar, wind, and hydro, and biomass. Oh, my goodness. You're just not going to get enough electricity from that. Now, will you still need some extra electricity? Probably from the fossil fuels, probably. Maybe not, but it depends on the size of your consumption, but I imagine you probably will. But still, if you can have that cost locked down for the rest of your life, you're basically paying it now to never have much of a cost, if any, for your electricity bill in the future, regardless of what the political winds are today. I just think it's a wonderful thing to consider, without question. Now, look, you got to understand how solar works. This is not solar thermal. This is solar photovoltaic, where you're turning the sun's energy into electricity. So the sun, on average, gives you, when the sun is at peak capacity, is yielding about, I guess, 1,200 watts per square meter in the world. So worldwide, it's about 1,200 watts per square meter. On the peak, the sun's average. So overhead, no cloud cover, it's about 1,200. Now, on average, but that doesn't do anything, because it's not like that 24/7. So you got to understand how it works. On average, the sun, and I'll use Atlanta, will give you about 170 watts, all right, is what it's doing, 170 watts. You times that by 24, and then you divide by 20%. Let me tell you why. So yeah, on average in Atlanta, you're getting 170 watts is what the sun is generating of energy that can be turned into electricity. All right, now, why isn't it 1,200? Because the sun doesn't shine 24 hours a day. I mean, there's, believe it or not, the sun goes down, it's nighttime. When it's nighttime, there is no sun energy that you can turn into any kind of thermal power or electricity. So, all right, so the 1,200 watts that the sun shines at peak, well, what's the average on a 24-hour day? And that's 170. Now, you times that 170 by whatever it is. I don't know what 24 times 170 is. Now, give you your average watts over the course of a day. All right, so times 170 watts times 24 hours, and you're going to get your amount of sun energy over the course of a day. Now, you divide that, that'll be your kilowatt hours, is what it's called. So, yeah, I wish I knew what that was. I don't know what it is on top of my head, but that'll give you your kilowatt hours. So, for every square meter in Atlanta, you're going to get 170 watts times 24. Whatever that number is, that'll be your, and then you divide that by 1,000. It's getting a little bit too complex, I get it, but that'll give your kilowatt hours per day. All right, now, what you got to do is, because the sun, you can't do 100% efficiency. Physics says you simply can't take 170 watts and turn those into 170 watts that you can use electricity-wise. You got to divide by the efficiency of the solar PV panel, and we'll just say 20% in this case, and you never get 100%. You'll never get more than 30%. It's not going to happen on any mass production. Just physics. I mean, just look at the physics behind this. So right now, I think in mass produce, you're probably looking at 15% efficiency. If you want to pay a little bit more, you can get 20%. Probably actually not a little bit more, a lot more. Still 20% efficiency. So, for every meter square, all right, that you have of a solar panel, you'll get about 1.5 kilowatt hours on the course of a day. All right, so one day will give you about 1.5 kilowatt hours of electricity for every meter square that you have. So how big is your roof? Well, you got to figure out how many meters square will your roof to contain that are south facing in which to generate that level of electricity. Let's just say 10. We can put 10 up there for simplicity. What you're going to get was that 1.5 times 10, whatever that is. You'll get 10 kilowatt hours a day if you have 10 solar panels on your roof. All right, well, that's pretty good because most houses use I'm using about 50. Now, I got a pretty big house with six people in the house. Lots of, we do our dryer is done by electricity. The heating water is done by electricity, not by natural gas. Our oven is done by electricity. So we have a lot of heating, a lot of blow dryers because the girls, electricity. So a lot of our heating consumption, which is the biggest load by far, is done by electrical, which simply is the biggest load that you're going to have on your electrical demand, right? So basically, for our house, I think it's right in about 55 kilowatt hours a day is what we're spending in our house, is what we're consuming. So if I was able to get solar panels on there that could generate, again, I'm just using 10, this is real back of the envelope stuff, and I invite you to go deeper to your own, that generate, we'll just say 11 kilowatt hours a day. So I'm basically able to get rid of 22% roughly of my electricity bill if I were to get solar panels on my home as we sit here today, all right? Because now I've locked down those 11 kilowatt hours that right now I'm paying 8 cents a kilowatt hour. Now people say, well, that's not worth it. Oh, it is worth it, my friends. Let me tell you why. Because as each kid gets out of the house, all right, our consumption of electricity will decline, bar none. Our consumption of electricity was just Charlotte and me. Our electrical consumption will go down probably by 3/4. So by then, we're probably consuming 15 kilowatt hours, of which 11 comes from my solar panels. That's on 10. That's on 10 solar panels on my rooftop. It'll really just reel back the envelope. How much does that cost? I'm going to say $30,000 to put that on there. So essentially, I have 3/4 of my electrical cost paid for that I never have to pay for again, ever. Now, the lifespan of a photovoltaic panel is probably 20 to 30 years, all right? So now I'm retired. That thing will probably last me before I have to renew it almost my entire life. So that's pretty good, man. I mean, think about it. You have essentially the vast majority of your electricity paid for on the front end that will cover you for the entirety of your retirement. Now, a couple of things to consider. I won't do that here in this house because we will downsize. And when the kids are out of the house and we downsize, you don't want to have to sell a home with solar panels if that's unique to your neighborhood. I'm just telling you, it sounds good in theory, but a lot of people are still, it's kind of like how electric vehicles kind of came to the forefront. A lot of people are still worried about the EVs. And it's still a worry. I mean, without question. I mean, I'm driving right now on 400 in North Georgia, and you know, there's actually one right there. But the vast majority of vehicles, and that's a Prius, so that's actually a hybrid. So the vast majority of vehicles are still internal combustion engines. A lot of people are still concerned with electric vehicles. You've heard about the cold winters that we've had this year that really put a damper on some of those Tesla batteries and whatnot. So I think electric vehicles are probably not the mainstay that a lot of people initially expected, just because a lot of people are hesitant. And people are afraid of change, for sure. So they might go the Prius route, which is back there, because it is a hybrid. It has an internal combustion engine with electrical component to it. So you got kind of the best of both worlds, or maybe the worst of both worlds, however you want to look at it. But still, electric vehicles have been around for a long time. They haven't taken off. But just look at all these cars out there. ICEs, as far as the eye can see, at least here in Atlanta. I imagine the rest of the United States as well. So if you have solar panels on your home and you're in a neighborhood that doesn't have solar panels, it's going to be hard to sell your house. So it's just all there is to it. Now, some enterprising people say, hey, it might say that's great. But I'm just telling you, they're going to see, they don't know about it. They're ignorant of how it works. They might even look at you. Utility bill and say, look, I haven't paid hardly anything. that might be a selling point to some, but I just don't think so. I think most people say, I don't know, man. That's different what I'm used to, and change is tough for people to contend with. So I have a sneaky suspicion it'll actually be a negative on selling your property if you have solar panels. So I would wait until I'm probably 55, an empty nester, and I'm looking at where I'm going to be. Either I'm in the place I want to be for the base of the bulk of my retirement, or I've already downsized before I did this. But we'll just use Charlotte and me. So I'll be 55 and 48 and a half now. I'll be 55 in 7 years. Liam will be getting ready to get out of high school. So I'll be probably 57 is when we'll leave this house in Georgia to downsize. At that point, we'll probably buy a three-bedroom, two-bath ranch, one floor, right? And that'll be good if it's 1 floor because you have more roof space, actually. And then, you know, with a basement where one of my kids can sleep in when they come home. And that will be, so you want more roof space. So a ranch is going to be better for solar, just get more roof space. Unless, again, you're going to put it on your yard. If you put it on your yard, it's more efficient, without question, as opposed to rooftops. But, you know, how many retirees want a big piece of land that they can put solar panels on? I don't know. I mean, I just don't know. But anyway, either way. So when we downsize, we're definitely going to move to a smaller home, a single floor, which again gives us more roof space, so we can put more panels on there, and we'll lock down our electricity bill. And probably by then, a 15% efficiency will seem like yesterday's news. 20% will be more the realm, and you can probably get 20% at the same cost you're getting 15% today. So that'd be good. And so now we got our electricity bill will drop in like by 3/4. All right. So we have, even if it costs us 15 kilowatt hours a day in our home for electricity, if we can get 11 to 12 from the solar panels, man, we've just locked that bill down significantly. I just tell you, man. And that's, you know, that's grid tied. And again, that means you're selling it back to the grid, or you're still drawing off the grid. But by then, they're going to have the transmission switch stuff where you can actually go grid tied and off grid if you want. That remains to be seen. But that, you know, when you're on grid, that means when the lights go out because the utility had a tornado rip through a transmission line, you still have to, you can't go turn on your solar panels to give you electricity. It doesn't work like that. You have to have a generator still. But when you have a transmission switch, we can turn it off grid and on grid without having to worry about electrocuting a lineman. Then the lights go down. Man, you just turn that sucker on. You got your electricity from your battery bank that you have set up. Hopefully you have a battery bank with your solar panels. Man, you're in a good place right there. You know what? You've locked down the cost of electricity for the rest of your life, probably. You don't have to worry about the increasing cost of inflation, the increasing cost if certain people win political office about non-renewables, fossil fuels, and you still have electricity that you can actually even sell back to the grid, maybe for a higher price than what you paid for it, if the regulatory environment changes against the average person when it comes to how much it costs for electricity, because electricity is needed and it's not cheap, and it's only going to get more expensive with more and more regulation. So do it now while you have the cash flow, while you're not worried about it. When I say do it now, I'm looking at Josh 8 years, 9 years from now, when I'm getting ready to downsize, getting ready to go to one-story house that Charlotte and I can live in for the bulk of our retirement. I have a sneaky suspicion, too, though, no matter what happens, there will be more and more solar on people's rooftops as we go forward. Like, there will be more and more electric vehicles. I mean, I don't have any issue considering that more electric vehicles are going to, you know, I don't think they'll ever dominate the market like we've expected anytime soon, but they'll come. I mean, because there's a electric vehicle. I don't want to get too deep in it, but drive one, man. I mean, if people say, electric vehicle, no, man, they drive fine. They drive wonderfully well, but they are expensive. They're expensive to change the batteries, and they still are relatively unknown, and people don't like that. So anyway, but it's gonna happen, and when it does, it will be more and more. It'll be easier to sell your house when more and more people have solar, for sure. So anyway, get it done now, or at least consider it. If you're not sure how to run the numbers, I highly suggest you do that. You read books. You go to, Michael Blue Jay, who's a big lib, go to his website, but he has a calculation, all this stuff. And I'm a big fan of Michael Blue Jay's work. Read David McKay. I've talked about his book, Sustainable Energy Without the Hot Air. Go to EIA, the Energy Administration. Is it Energy Information? I can't remember what it's called. EIA, good night. I can't believe I can't remember all these acronyms. I can't remember. But just figure it out, how solar works. Don't just take some solar salesman's pitch for it. Figure it out for sure, because you need to know. All right, we'll see you next time. Thanks now.